So we have studied so far small signal amplifiers in a curriculum, and we have to see the contrast difference, what is the meaning of the power amplifier is. So basically in a small signal amplifier, the input required was very small, around 20 millivolts. And the output was around, it was limited by, the output was around, let's say, max till the DC power supply. So let's say we have an output of 6 volts. But in case of power amplifier, when we say we have a power amplifier, we will require an input of around, let's say, 10 volts. So we will have an input of 10 volts peak to peak, which is quite large. And output may also be more about same only. Maybe let's say it will be 12 volts peak to peak. So what is the difference between this power amplifier and this small signal amplifier which we have studied? So in the small signal amplifiers, we have studied a lot of topics. So we have studied single stage. Then we have studied multi-stage. And then we have studied cascade, cascode, and etc. So all these were the categories belonging to small signal amplifier. The power requirement for small signal amplifiers is very, very less. So here the power requirement in this case is less than a watt, less than 1 watt, not even watts. We have few milliwatts. So the power requirement for a small signal amplifier is quite less. So this is all my power and power. This is how the small signal amplifier's criteria is. The power requirement is less. Now let's talk about the power amplifier. In the power amplifiers, the power requirement is quite huge. The power requirement here is around, let me just write over here. The power requirement in power amplifiers is greater than 10 watts. So obviously when we have power requirement of more than 10 watts, we cannot use a normal small signal transistors, which we have earlier seen. Earlier, we have used normal BJT, BC547. All those were small signal BJTs, which were not able to handle more than 1 watt of power. Now we cannot use those simple BJTs or FETs or MOSFETs for a power amplifier. So for a power amplifier, since the power requirement is more, now here actually it is not actually amplifying the amplitude. Basically, it's amplifying the current. So the current requirement, the current is boosting, getting boosted up in power amplifiers. So in power amplifiers, let me just write over here, the current is boosted up. So in small signal amplifiers, the current requirement was around very small, maybe less than around a few milliampere. The current requirement for the transistors used in power amplifier is around in amperes. So obviously when we the current requirement here is boosted up in amperes. So you have around 1 amperes to around 10 amperes of current flowing through the transistors. So if you use the same transistors which we used for small signal amplifiers, definitely this will not work. So hence there is a requirement of special transistors only meant for the use of power amplifiers. Now those transistors are called as power transistors, and power transistors are of different categories. So two categories are power BJT and power MOSFET. So this is what you have in your curriculum. You have a power BJT and power MOSFET, which will have extremely high power capacity, that is the current rating is extremely high. Voltage rating, well, it might be slightly higher, but overall the power requirement for power amplifiers will be slight, will be very, very high. And these power BJT and power MOSFET we'll see shortly in the handout. And also why there is a requirement for a heat sink. So you also require heat sinks. So why are heat sinks required? Heat sinks, well, you must have seen a heat sink inside a DC power supply inside your lab. Behind you have a black color kind of a, you know, arrangement. That is a heat sink basically. So basically your transistors, which are power transistors, are dissipating a very high current. So it gets heated up. So to dissipate the heat or to reduce the junction temperature, right, we require these heat sinks. The heat sink will be providing an external space, a more space for that heat to move out of the ambient, move out into the environment. So that's why we will see shortly what is the requirement of a heat sink also. So this is in short the module number 4. Module number 4 starts with the requirement of a power transistor. Then we move on to the power BJT and a power MOSFET. And then we see why we require heat sinks and what are the characteristics. So this is in short the summary of why, what is power amplifier. In power amplifier also, we will study various classes. So power amplifier, we will study various classes, which are, I will show it to you now. It has different classes. So you have class A power amplifier in your curriculum, class B, class AB, class C. So you have these categories. In class A, you have series fed, class A power amplifier, and you have transformer coupled. Transformer coupled class A power amplifier. Then you have class B power amplifier, class AB, and class C. You have this different classes depending upon the some criteria that I'll show you shortly now. So this is in short the summary. So basically power amplifier are boosting up the current. Well, it may amplify slightly the voltage, but not that much. And the input applied to the power amplifier is quite high. So basically one more thing I want to point out is this. So you must have studied the DC load line. You have your DC load line something like this. So this was your DC load line. Now in the study of power amplifiers, you will study something called as AC load line. The AC load line concept is extremely important, and you should know how to draw AC load line properly. Now, if you have, this was the summary and the overview of power amplifiers and why they are required and different classes of it, and why we have power transistors, power BJT, power MOSFET, the concept of heat sink, the power requirement, the current requirement, and all those things which we have not studied in small signal amplifiers. We'll be studying in the power amplifier. So remember the differences. The differences are, again I repeat, the input amplitude, the AC amplitude is quite big. Contrast to this, here we have around millivolts, here we have 10 volts peak to peak. So maybe a small signal amplifier output may be fed to the input of a power amplifier. So I will, so as previously informed, power transistors are required in power amplifiers. So in this section, we will describe the characteristics of BJT and MOSFET power transistors. Basically, they are not much different. Only the current rating and the voltage rating are slightly different. And then we'll see why heat sinks are required, which will explain the temperature and the heat flow of the device. So let us go back to the power BJT. So since the first, I'll show you the rating. So these are typically the ratings of a small signal BJT and a power BJT. These are the two commercial BJTs which are available. So VCE max is my collector to emitter maximum voltage. In a small signal BJT, it's around 40. And for a power BJT, it's slightly more. As I've told you, the voltage requirement is not that much great compared to your voltage small signal BJT. It is slightly increasing. And for higher current voltage requirement, where you have a very high power requirement, you have a high voltage rating over here, that is 270. Now, notice the current. The current requirement in a small signal BJT is around 0.8 ampere. That is around 800 milliampere. Whereas for a power BJT, the current rating is around 15 amperes, which is quite a lot. And this power BJT, since the voltage is higher, the current requirement here is around 7 amperes. The maximum power dissipation, as I've told you earlier, in a small signal BJT is around less than a watt. So around watts, 1 watt around. And for a power BJT, the maximum power dissipation can go to few tens of watts or hundreds of watts. So here, this commercially available power BJT has a rating of 115, and here it is having a rating of 45. Now, normally beta is basically IC upon IB. For a small signal BJT, so far whatever we have studied, the small signal amplifiers, the single stage amplifiers, the multi-stage amplifiers, the cascode amplifiers, all were using small signal BJT. They were having a beta of quite less, that is around 35 to 100 or 200 beta value. Well, for a power BJT, the beta value is lowered significantly. So this is a one distinct feature, that is the power BJT, the beta value is around 5 to 20, very less compared to your small signal BJT. And FT, the maximum transition, the transit frequency, the maximum frequency this BJT can go is around 300 megahertz. And for a power BJT, this number falls down to a significantly lower value. So here the bandwidth of a BJT, small signal BJT amplifies around 300 megahertz, whereas the FT falls down to around 1 megahertz for a power BJT. So these are the comparison of the characteristics, which are extremely important to understand the difference between a power BJT and a small signal BJT. I hope these points are clear. Basically, we have to concentrate on these things. What is the differences between them? So there is one more important difference. The power transistors are large area devices. So basically, since the current and the voltage requirement is so much, that's why they require larger space, large area. So they are having, compared to small signal BJTs, they are different in the geometry, doping concentration and property. So this is basically theories, whatever we have described in the theorem, described in the box over here, in the table. Now we'll move ahead. So basically these are my, this is my output characteristics of a typical power BJT. So you can see, except for the change in the, there is a change in the voltage level, voltage magnitudes over here. Here the collector to emitter voltage is in, 10, that is 0 to 20 to 40 and max till 120. So these are your normal typical characteristics. But a BJT, a power BJT also suffers from a secondary breakdown. So what is a secondary breakdown? It's a continuous, it's again a feedback process where high current will lead to a high temperature, will again lead to a high current, will again lead to a high temperature. So it's like a positive feedback, self-destructing mechanism, which will destroy the device basically. So you should avoid using power BJT at such high ratings. And then you can read this stuff. The maximum rated power in a transistor is given by VCE into IC. And VCE, IC, we have just now seen. You should operate your power BJT in a safe operating region. You all can read more about the safe operating region in this handout. So if you operate it over here, it will operate it safely. There will be no secondary background, no secondary breakdown of this, and we don't dissipate too much of current. This is a simple example of the same. Now we'll go back to power MOSFET. Well, this is what a power MOSFET looks like. These are two power MOSFETs. As you can see, the power rating of them is extremely high. the power rating here is around 75 and here it is 20 watts. And the current is also very high. This is around 8 amperes and 2 amperes. So basically the drain current in a power MOSFET is in the ampere range and the breakdown voltage are in the 100 of volts. So these two things which you should remember. And how power MOSFET is superior over power BJT? In a power MOSFET, we are having a faster switching time. There is no secondary breakdown in a power MOSFET. So, and also the response of time, that is the gain and the time response over the wide temperature range, it is more stable in case of power MOSFET compared to power BJT. And these are some structures, the power MOSFET structures. There are some differences over here. Y'all can go through them and see the differences. And these are the typical characteristics of a power MOSFET. And here are some comparison points which are given for a power MOSFET and a BJT. Now we'll move our attention to heat sinks. So I have already told you the motivation of a heat sink. We have to reduce the junction temperature because the current carrying capacity for a power transistor, that is a power BJT and a power MOSFET, is too high. So the power dissipated in the transistor increases its internal temperature above the ambient temperature. So basically, if a device or a junction temperature becomes too high, the transistor may suffer permanent damage. So basically, you have to attach a heat sink on the surface of the BJT in such a way that it reduces the junction temperature. Because if the junction temperature of the BJT of a transistor increases, it will lead to a permanent damage, which we need to avoid. So these are the possible, these are the packaging mechanisms for a power transistor. Typically, you must have seen this. This is a plastic case, and these are the power transistors which I was talking about in the laboratory power supply, which are mounted on the backside, the black color one. And this is my plastic case and the metallic case. So these are the typical heat sinks. Here there is a provision to attach a heat sink, and this is the heat sink for this power transistor. So you all can read more about the heat sinks and how the if the heat sink is not used, what will happen and how does the temperature reduces. So here I will directly go through the comment of this numerical. You all can go through the numerical. So the use of a heatsink allows more power to be dissipated in the device while keeping the device temperature at a higher or a lower limit. So basically what it means is, if device has a power rating to work at a maximum power of 2.32 watts, with heatsink it can go up to a higher value. That means you can operate a power transistor or a power BJT or a power MOSFET at a much higher power dissipation capacity with the heat sink. So as you can see over here, when no heat sink is used, the maximum device power dissipation is this. And when the heat sink is used, the power dissipation is increased. And at the same time, the junction temperature is also reduced. So this will make sure that you are using the power transistor, and simultaneously, not only that you are using the power transistor, but also utilizing it such a way that the transistor is not damaged. So this is the overview of the power transistor, power BJT and a power MOSFET. This was the handout from Neiman. Now I'll just show you what we'll cover now next. We will cover after the break, we'll cover this topic, power amplifier. So I will take a break of 5 minutes. We'll meet after 5 minutes and we'll start with the topic of power amplifiers.